A Trip Home by Ed Gorman. Sully Donlin was working on deck when Kay came up from the cabin and said, "I was washing the windows down there, and I noticed there's some guy up there on the cliff with a pair of binoculars watching you." Donlin wore faded denim cutoffs, no shirt or shoes. She wore the same, except for a red cotton halter. McKenna's Cove was part of an island 90 miles north of Chicago. There were three summer houses on the island, one of them belonging to Donlin and his woman of the moment, as one of his more sardonic ex-roomies had described herself. Kay was a nurse at a medical clinic. Donlin had met her 6 weeks ago at a disco on the Gold Coast. She'd been celebrating her divorce from a neurosurgeon she'd helped put through med school, her repayment being a case of crabs he'd picked up from one of his numerous girlfriends. She was spending 1 week of her vacation on Donlin's island. She watched Donlin closely after bringing him the news. He didn't talk much about his life. All she knew for sure was that he was a wholesale salesman of power yachts. His own craft wasn't in that esteemed a class. It was a venerable old 19-footer that required a hardy seaman to keep it operating. Donlin's deep tan and muscular, wiry body attested to the hours he put into keeping it in max condition. Aware that she was watching him for a response to her news, he smiled and said, "Not me. The rig here. Everybody wants a look at it. Not many of these left." He went back to polishing some of the custom-made stainless steel fittings. "You're not even interested that somebody's up there watching us?"
"Nah. Why should I be? Free country, isn't it?"
"Well, it kind of spooks me." Donlin grinned.
"Flip him off. That'll get rid of him."
Later in the day, when they made love, she noticed how distracted he was. It was as if he'd sent a clone of himself to perform the sex. Even in July, the wind off the lake cooled the harsh temperature. She slept, fanned by a breeze that gave her goosebumps, until she covered her nakedness with a thin blanket. Then it was a perfect sleep. Once he was sure she was out for a while, he slipped off the bed, went to his ancient army duffel bag, and took out the Glock. The forest here ran to hardwood maples. The scent of loam and lake braced him for his search. He spent half an hour searching the land around the cabin. Next, he went down to the landing where the ferry for visitors docked. He was 10 feet from the landing when he heard the outhouse door upslope behind him squawk open. A voice said, "You looking for me?" Amazing what you could forget in 10 years. Of course, the man hadn't been either fat or bald then. They moved toward each other. No smiles, no arms open to manly embrace, no words of greeting. Dave said, "I didn't want to come here. I mean, just in case you think I've changed my mind about what a sleazy bastard you are, you better have a damn good reason to be here." The man was a stranger. Even the timbre of his voice was different. So damned strange. His own brother, with whom he'd shared a house for the first 16 years of his life, utterly lost to him now. "Well, it wouldn't be because of Mom. Because you wouldn't give a damn." "I don't have anything against her." "Well, that's damned nice of you." "Nora?" "No, because you wouldn't give a damn about her either." Donlin said, "Sam." "Yeah, Sam. The son you haven't contacted since he was 4 years old." Donlin didn't have to wait until his brother said the words. Donlin said them for him. "He died?"
"Yeah, he died."
"I'm sorry."
Dave smiled bitterly. Don't get me wrong, brother. We're all very happy you kept your word and didn't contact him. But I wanted to tell you that he died. I wanted to see your face when I told you.
How'd he die?
I should have known that's the part you'd be interested in. No tears for a young boy. Not good old Sully. I guess when you're a professional killer, that's the only thing that matters, huh? How he died.
Angry tears. His fat face jiggling with rage. I helped raise him, Sully. I loved him. I took the wife you lied to, and I made her my wife. And I took your son, and we made him our son.
He was blubbering. Donlan was embarrassed for him. Wind soughing in the trees, and perfect white clouds sailing the skies, and the nearby water embracing the shore. A day to enjoy. Not a day to see a grown man blubber without any pride.
I want to know how he died.
What difference does it make, Sully? You didn't give a damn about him.
Donlan shook his handsome head.
Don't tell me what I think. I thought about him a lot. I paid a neighbor lady on the sly to take pictures of him for me. They're all over my condo. So don't tell me what I do or do not think, because you don't know jack shit about it.
He took two threatening steps closer.
What I want to know is how he died.
Dave had given up his dramatics.
He was murdered. There's no other way to say it. And the law isn't going to do a damn thing about it.
Why not?
Wiping snot from his nose on the back of his shirt sleeve. Smiling. And looking ugly doing it. The brains had gone to Dave. The looks to Sully.
Remember all those causes I used to get so caught up in back in high school? And you'd tell me only wimps gave a damn about stuff like that?
Well, it was stuff like that, Sully, that got your son, my son, killed.
All Donlan could do was stand there and wonder what the hell his brother, his emotional do-gooder brother, Dave, was talking about.
She wants you to fly back with me. The funeral's tomorrow morning. She says it's only right that you should be there.
You don't sound real enthusiastic about that.
Far as I'm concerned, Sully, I wish you would have died in the Gulf War. Because something snapped in you over there.
Instead of emotional, he sounded cold, hard. I wish you would have died over there. For everybody's sake. Including mine.
You done with your little speech? Fuck yourself, Sully. I need 10 minutes to pack. You wait here.